Hello everyone, I'm Hendrik Niemeyer and today I'm going to give you an introduction to active learning. So what is active learning? It's basically a framework for applying supervised machine learning models if you have no labeled data available, but a human annotator with a limited budget who can provide you with ground truths. So a typical problem in the industry, I would say. A little disclaimer beforehand, this is not a talk about a certain Python package which you can use to solve this problem. It's more like a general talk about the algorithms which you can use to tackle these problems. I will, in the end, present some Python packages which are there and open source for solving this problem. But in principle, these algorithms are, let's say, very basic, and you can, everybody of you can implement them on their own using a few lines of code if you're using scikit-learn. So basically, you don't need certain Python packages for this problem. But if you want, you can still download them from GitHub and use them because they are doing the same. They're using the scikit-learn API, basically. So some little words about me. I'm a theoretical physicist. I did a PhD in theoretical physics and ventured into data science 5 years ago. And mostly right now, I'm concerned with solving computer vision problems. I was already here last year where I gave a talk on synthetic data for machine learning. Maybe someone was already there then. And yeah. Feel free also to contact me about everything you want to know about this talk or my last talk or any other machine learning related topics if you're interested. And the slides from my talk this year and from my talk last year, you can find on our company GitHub, which where the link is just below here on the slides. There are also other talks by my colleagues. One is happening right now and another one tomorrow, but you will find the slides on the same GitHub repository as well. So I'm also interested in other topics like big data infrastructure, Docker, Python as well, Python in general. You can also contact me about this. And please also feel free to come by our booth because we are a sponsor here at the conference. So a little bit about our company. What are we doing? This is not really relevant for the topic. A little bit relevant, let's say. So the Rosen Group is a service provider for diagnostic solutions. Diagnostic solutions for certain assets like pipelines or plants or sheets of metal. And this means we build measurement devices to assess the functionality and integrity of such assets. And as you can imagine, if you build measurement devices and inspect whole pipelines or oversee whole plants, you generate a large amount of data. And in the beginning, this is also a large amount of unlabeled data, which you have to handle. And this is the motivation for my talk, how to deal with large amounts of unlabeled data, because you have to deal with it. Because if you don't deal with it, you can create damage out there in the world, which we are hired to prevent. Yeah. And a last remark. So we are hiring if you are interested in getting a position in data science or data engineering or software development, just also come by our booth. And this is no more recruiting or marketing pitches from now on. Yeah, so I will tell you a little bit about the kind of data we are working with. It's a computer vision related problem, but not really like computer vision because we are using measurement devices which are not natural photos, but something like ultrasound, for example, or other data. But in principle, we're solving computer vision problems. So what kind of data are we dealing with, for example? So ultrasound is something everybody knows, but another popular technique, for example, if you're inspecting pipelines, is magnetic flux leakage, which is something most people don't know if they're not from the same industry as I am. So therefore, I will explain it a little bit and tell you why this is basically also a computer vision problem. So in magnetic flux leakage, what do? You take a huge permanent magnet, put it up to a sheet of metal, magnetize it, and then you look if you can measure a magnetic field outside of the steel. And the magnetic flux leakage effect is basically this: if you have a defect in your sheet of metal, so which you can see here in the top picture, if you have something like a corrosion or a crack, then magnetic field lines will leak out of the steel, which you can then, for example, measure with a Hall sensor, and then you have data. We do this, for example, in pipelines, so we bring measurement devices in the pipeline, which travel several hundred kilometers through the whole pipeline and record this magnetic data at, let's say, every 2 millimeters. And this is a huge amount of data, and it's basically just like an image. You can see it here in the top, in the image on the bottom. You have 2D data, you have two axes, one around the circumference of a pipeline, one along the flow axis, and at every point you have a measurement. It's basically a grayscale image here shown in a color map from EMShow from Matplotlib. And now what is the task? So we want to assess the integrity, for example, of such a pipeline, and then we need to detect regions where the pipeline might fail, classify the data there into certain kind of defects like a crack or a corrosion or something which was already there in the construction of a pipeline like a weld and is therefore not a risk for the pipeline. So this is basically a computer vision problem. You detect stuff, you classify stuff. And therefore we are facing similar problems like you do in normal computer vision with natural photographies where you want to also detect stuff and classify stuff and use the same machine learning algorithms and the same ideas. Now, what is the motivation for active learning? So if we do a lot of measurements and we do a huge amount of measurements every year, then you collect a huge amount of unlabeled data. And now it's the question, it's really like, if I want to do a machine learning algorithm on such data, I need to label it. And the data we gather, there experienced human annotators can label the data. But of course, we have only a limited budget for labeling. I cannot say, here is a petabyte of measurement data, please label it. This will cost insane amounts of money. So I have to decide what portion of the data the annotator should label for me so that I could develop my machine learning algorithm. And I also have to decide not what kind of portion, also how many should he label, or what is my budget I should allocate to labeling data. And can I stop before my budget is exceeded? Maybe I don't use that. Maybe I can see if I need less labeling than I thought before. And this culminates in the ultimate question, is there a way of selecting images to be labeled by a human annotator and how to do this best? And this is essentially active learning. Finding a way in a huge pool of unlabeled data, find a way to select the parts of the pool of data which should be labeled at best with a minimum budget. And for example, in a normal computer vision problem, you would do this by, for example, allocating money to Amazon Mechanical Turk, which you see on the right side if you're doing normal computer vision. Or if you're at a university, you would pay some bachelor students to label your data, or at an industry, your interns or trainees. So how does active learning look if you put it up in a diagram? So this is an image I took from a very famous active learning paper by Burr Settles from 2010. They compiled a survey on active learning, which is very much worth a read because it's a big paper and it basically explains all the standard algorithms and methods for active learning. So if this is your only takeaway from this talk, is read this paper. So the basic idea is you have a pool of unlabeled data, just as I explained. You could also have a stream of unlabeled data, but then you would need different kind of algorithms. And what you now do is you have an algorithm here in orange called select queries, which is basically selecting one or several instances of your data to be given to the human annotator. The human annotator can provide the ground truth. The ground truth can be noisy, but can also be 100% correct, depending on your situation. The labeled data is then added to the pool of labeled training data called L here. On this pool of labeled training data, a classifier is trained, which can then be used to make predictions on the pool of unlabeled data, and the process starts all over again. It's like an iterative process, of course. And what's interesting here is how you design the algorithms with which you select instances from the pool of unlabeled data. So we have different sources of information here for such a query algorithm. We have the prediction of the classifier, which we trained on the subset of labeled data. So we can use its predictions to make assumptions about our data. We have also the features in the pool of unlabeled data and domain knowledge about our problem. We have behavior of the human annotator, which we could use. So there's a lot of sources of information such a query algorithm can use to select instances. And the part of training a machine learning model is also interesting, but not the focus of the task. You could plug in here every standard classifier you can think of, from a decision tree to a random forest to a convolutional neural network. It's not important what kind of machine learning model you want to train. The important part is how to select the instances, and that the classifier you train can make predictions on unlabeled data, which every kind of classifier can, of course. And in the end, the only one thing which is missing from the diagram here is how do you measure convergence at the end, when to stop. But this we will talk about later. So what is the basic dilemma of such an active learning problem? It's the same as, for example, multi-armed bandit theory or reinforcement learning. You have basically an exploration versus exploitation dilemma. In the beginning, at round zero, you know nothing about your data. You just have a large unlabeled pool of data. And what you now basically can do is you can start, for example, exploring the feature space, finding classes, and so on. And at some point you might decide, okay, now I think I know a lot about the feature space, and I just want to make the perfect classifier. I just want to exploit the information I just have right now. I just want to fine tune my decision boundaries. I don't need to look at outliers anymore, because I think I am in a situation where I only need to fine tune my classifier. And this is basically the same as you would have in a, for example, multi-armed bandit problem. They would have, I don't know, N slot machines or multi-armed bandits with different payouts. You don't know in the beginning. And in the beginning, if you start, you would just try out different slot machines and see how they pay out over time, until you think you have found out which has the best payout scheme and use this all the time. And this is exactly the same here. You have to find out when do you have to stop to look at certain outliers or certain clusters in the feature space, which are far away from your current decision boundary, for example. Do I have discovered all available classes of my problem in a multi-class problem? Maybe I don't know all the classes which exist in my classification problem beforehand. And if I know or have a guess that I'm finished, then I can start fine-tuning my decision boundary with exploiting the information I already have and looking only at stuff which is, for example, close to a decision boundary. Yeah, and this is basically the basic dilemma. And now I will start to talk about the basic algorithms which you can use to select the instances for the human annotator to label. And these kind of algorithms are divided in two main classes. The first class is the one which doesn't use information from a classifier, but uses only information about the feature space itself. And the second class of algorithms mainly use the classifier, or the prediction of the classifier on the unlabeled pool of data, to make its decisions. And both these kinds of algorithms have their use, because in the beginning, for example, you don't have a classifier. You need to start somewhere. But in the end, if you want to fine-tune your decision boundary, you, of course, need to incorporate information from your classifier. So what is the most basic query algorithm for selecting an instance? Just throw a dice. Select one at random. And this is useful because this is an algorithm which will eventually explore the whole feature space. It will visit every point in feature space, and is a good starting point if you don't know anything about your problem and you need to start somewhere. If you have no labeled data, then you need to select a sample from somewhere, and maybe you select the first 10 or 20 samples at random. and have a starting point. It is also a baseline algorithm because it's the algorithm with the slowest rate of convergence. So what I mean by baseline algorithm is if you come up with an own idea for a selection algorithm for instances, which you might already have by thinking about the problem, then you usually test it against a random query. If your algorithm performs better than selecting just instances at random, then you have found something. But if you are on par or even subpar performance with random selection, then you usually made a mistake or your idea has not worked out. Because there is no way to you can just not select something, which is also be slower, but random selection is usually the slowest converging algorithm for selecting instances. But it's in the end a good starting point before more sophisticated algorithms set in. You could also use a deterministic varying. It's more like you don't throw a dice or select at random, but you know something about your problem. You have domain knowledge about your problem. Then you know in my feature space, for example, I know if feature number 5 is greater than 12. Maybe I should select this because my domain knowledge about the problem says this is an interesting region in feature space, which I should look at. So you could come up with algorithms which just select slices of your feature space for your annotator to label. This is also, like random sampling, a good starting point if you have domain knowledge about your problem. And it is also, like random sampling, a good algorithm for discovering new classes if you have a multi-class problem and might even know in the beginning how much classes you have in your problem. But it also suffers from the same convergence speed as random sampling. It will be slow to converge. But if you design it well, you could also design it that it visits every part of feature space, for example. One last algorithm which you can use if you want to or do not want to use the classifier is look at clusters. So what we, for example, do in our application, we cluster our pool of unlabeled data with, for example, k-means or something more sophisticated. Then you have a finite amount of clusters and you give to the human annotator samples from each cluster to label. And then if you train your classifier, look how homogeneously labeled a cluster and feature space is. And based on this, you can say, okay, maybe I should give the annotator more data points from this cluster because it's, I don't know, 50-50, class 1, class 2. But cluster number 3 is, I don't know, 10 samples labeled by the annotator as class 1, and prediction from the machine learning classifier is also class 1, no class 2, then I don't know, I don't have to look at it, maybe. It's also a heuristic algorithm and good for exploring your feature space, because if you cluster and visit every cluster, you might also visit every corner of your feature space. Can help you also with class discovery, but it's, again, not very sophisticated. You are not using much information the classifier you train on your labeled data generates. You might use it if you look at the homogeneity of a cluster based on the unlabeled samples, but not more. You're not using the internals of the classifier to make a decision. So now we're coming to the algorithms which are, or I would dub, a little bit more sophisticated, which are using the actual classifier you train on your data. And these are also the examples you find in most papers and textbooks about active learning. The stuff I told you before, the random sampling, the deterministic sampling, and the cluster homogeneity, you not always find in papers. Random always because it's the baseline, but the other stuff, is we didn't invent it, but it's something we found useful in our applications of active learning. Because if you know something about the problem, then deterministic querying helps you. Yeah. So what can you do if you have a classifier trained on your data? So the most famous algorithm of active learning is uncertainty sampling. So most classifiers you find in standard software packages like scikit-learn have a predict probar method. So you predict the probability of a class for your unlabeled sample. And this you can use to see how certain a classifier is about its labeling decision. How do you do that? So there are mainly three methods. The first method is, okay, usually, as you can see in the topmost formula, you select the label which has the highest probability of labels, of course. And if you take one minus this probability, you have a measurement for how uncertain the classifier is. So if your probability of the selected class is 0.9, then of course the classifier is really, really sure about this sample. But if the assigned probability to your selected class is 0.51, then your classifier is not so sure. And if you then take, if you look at one minus this and select based on that, you get samples where the classifier is very unsure about, like the 0.5% probability sample. And giving this sample to a human annotator might help increase the performance of your classifier, because it's a sample close to the decision boundary and the classifier is unsure about it. But it uses only very little information of the classifier. So if you look at the formula in the middle, the XM is a star. This is called the margin sampling. This means you don't look only at the class with the highest probability, but you look at the two classes with the highest probability. So the one which came in first and was selected the label, and the class which came in second, and look at the difference of the probabilities. So for example, if you have a problem with, I don't know, 100 or 1,000 classes, and yeah, the highest probability is 0.7 for a certain class, and then the second highest probability is 0.1, then you have a margin of 0.6, and the distance between the most probable classes is very high, so you can assume that this is a label or a class where the classifier is really, really sure about it, and you probably don't have to present it to the human annotator. But if the difference is very small, so highest probability is, I don't know, 0.51, and the second highest probability is 0.49, then this is also an instance where the classifier is really unsure about it, and you should probably or can probably give it to the human annotator to improve the performance. And if you want to use information about all available classes and labels, you can just compute the entropy about the whole probability distribution, because you want to give to the human annotator basically instances where the probability distribution of classes is flat. If you have a peaked probability density of classes, you don't have to give it to the annotator. And the number of or the amount of information you use in computing this measure increases from just computing one minus the highest probability to using the full entropy. So how does it look like, for example, for a three classes problem? The most informative sample is, of course, in the middle of the triangle where all three probability of all three classes are almost the same. So if you have such a situation, this is an instance which you should give to an annotator. And the three algorithms basically only differ at the edges of the space of possible class probabilities. So the entropy has the advantage that it does not favor instances where only one of the classes is highly unlikely, so along the outer edges of such a diagram, because such a sample would also not be beneficial for the human annotator, because a machine learning model might be unsure about several classes, but it's really, really sure that this is not this one class. Yeah. And it's only, let's say, these are more like theoretical differences. In reality, you would not make a decision about such an query algorithm based on theoretical decisions you might want to incorporate in your process of design, but in the end you will always test such systems so that these considerations, maybe from such a diagram you would say, okay, entropy is always better than margin or least confidence sampling, but for your certain problem which you want to solve, this might not be the case if you test it. But This uncertainty sampling, despite its popularity, has one big advantage. It's a pure exploitation-based algorithm. You only select stuff which is near a decision boundary of your classifier, and this might not always be helpful for your problem. So, for example, here you see a two-class problem where you have two classes, the red triangle class and the green square class. And someone has selected two samples of this data set already. One is green square, one is red triangle. And the decision boundary of the favorite classifier we trained is the blue line. And right now, if we want, if we applied uncertainty sampling to select the next label for the annotator to look at, this would be the point which is marked as A here on this graphic. And this point might not be useful to our problem because it's an outlier. It's far away from the high density regions of the feature space. And basically, we don't care what class it is. It might be more beneficial to label the point which is marked B here, which is in a high density area of the feature space. And it might be important if it's a red triangle or a green square. But again, this is only a theoretical consideration. The performance of such algorithms needs to be tested in on real data sets which you have. So this is only to give you a hint of how these algorithms work. I don't mean to say by it that uncertainty sampling is a bad algorithm per se. It can be good, it can be bad. You don't know until you test it. So there is another technique which is related to the uncertainty sampling. This is called query by committee. There you train a set of classifiers on your data instead of just one, like an ensemble, for example. And you select the instance where the classifiers most disagree about. So you query regions in feature space which are controversial, so to say. And for example, you could use standard ensembling techniques like begging and stuff like that to construct such an ensemble. And if you look at the formula here, which is the selection formula, so the XVE, this is much related to uncertainty sampling. Here it's a voting entropy instead of an entropy over a probability distribution. So therefore it's highly related to uncertainty sampling and has basically mostly the same advantages and disadvantages as uncertainty sampling. So right now we have looked at where a classifier is uncertain, but we are not basically in the end interested in the fact that the classifier is uncertain. We are interested in, let's say, achieving a high accuracy on our data set. So maybe it's more beneficial to look for samples or instances which have a high likelihood of changing my classifier. This is called expected model change. So this means we select the instance which implies the greatest change of the current classifier if its label would be known. So every classifier has some kind of parameters, weights in a neural network, for example, and we then look for the instance which might change all the weights in my neural network the most if I label it. The problem here is we don't know the true labels of our unlabeled data pool. So we have to do something like an expectation value over the change of gradient if we add the label to a set of labeled data points. This you see here in the formula above, you have an expectation value based on the current classifier about the label probabilities, and then the absolute value of the gradient under the assumption that I add this certain data point with this certain label to my training set. And of course, this can be computationally expensive because you have to look at every data point and every label and compute the gradient. But it might help. And maybe you use easy classifiers where it's quite easy to compute a gradient, and then it might help you. You can take this idea even further and say, okay, I'm also not really interested in model change. Model change is not my metric I use for evaluating machine learning algorithms. I want to look at the accuracy of my classifier. So maybe I can compute an expectation value of the accuracy increase or accuracy change if I add an instance to my set of label training data. And this is called expected error reduction. So we want to select an instance which has a high likelihood of increasing my accuracy or a high likelihood of decreasing my classification error. But again here, we don't know the two labels, so we have to do expectation values based on the current classifier. And this again has also very high computational costs. Again, for every combination of data point and label, you have to train your classifier anew to evaluate such a criterion. You can, of course, approximate it, for example, with Monte Carlo sampling about the feature space, or you have methods of approximately training a classifier, then this becomes easier. But in the end, this is a method with the highest computational costs. And what you see here is why uncertainty sampling is the most popular algorithm, because it's very easy to compute. The computational complexity increases with every further algorithm here I presented. And you see here in the formula below, which is this selection process for the new instance, it has two expectation values, a lot of training new classifiers, and basically you seldomly want to do that. And yes, you have to some ways to approximate this. And in the end, the question is which algorithm for selecting an instance I should use. So this is basically two answers. One is you have a cold start problem. For if you start new with a new data set, you don't have a classifier. You need something like random sampling, deterministic sampling, clustering, and stuff like that, because you have no classifier information. You need to balance somehow exploration and exploitation to be sure that you are going in the right direction. And from my point of view, where I have applied these methods to several industrial applications, the best strategy is just combine everything and iterate over different methods and test this. So what worked best in our case was just switching, for example, between randomness, uncertainty sampling, expected model change, and then back and forth again. But we have tested it. Testing is here the most important thing, because there is no theoretical guarantee that selection algorithm B will always perform better than A, depending on your problem. There's no general answer, so you have to test it. And this brings me to the last part of the talk, how to test it. Well, one part we usually do is we have, if we develop something new here, we have already data sets which are fully labeled and are similar problems, and then you can simulate active learning. You don't need to use a human, you just, when the human would come into place as the annotator, you just via the computer give the correct label, or maybe have, say, 90% probability of correct label and 10% of a wrong label if you want to simulate a more realistic human. And then you measure over time the classification error or your accuracy or whatever metric you track, and compare it with several strategies or several meta strategies where you combine different algorithms. And in the end, you want to have a graph like this. You want to perform always better than random. So here's for some problem, which I took also from the Burr-Settles paper, a comparison of random sampling versus uncertainty sampling. And you see here, if uncertainty sampling always performs better over time than random sampling, and if this was your problem and your selection algorithms, then you would be sure you're making a good decision here. You can also compare this to a baseline performance if you already knew all labels, or you know all labels from your test set. So you can compute a baseline performance over the whole data set, and this is the value of your metric to which the active learning algorithms should converge to in the end. And you can also test with real humans, because in the end, you might develop some kind of website or UI application or Amazon Mechanical Turk plugin. So you should see how humans react to it and how their performance is on the data set as well. And the last part is basically when to stop your labeling. Well, there are three answers. The first one is very easy. You have a limited budget, like 90 hours for this intern or $1 million for Amazon Mechanical Turk. If this is exhausted, you stop. The second one is if you have the annotator at your lab or at your company, you can train them to notice convergence. So convergence here means that the labeling decisions of the classifier won't change much with each iteration. So the annotator gets a new instance, labels it, the classifier is trained anew, and the prediction on the unlabeled data pool doesn't change anymore. Then you have converged. If you can train your annotator to notice this, maybe with visual aids, like a graph which shows a labeling change or a visualization of your feature space, then he might be able to say, okay, I'm finished, I should stop working on this project and, I don't know, look at the next data set, for example. Or you could develop a stopping criterion on your own based on, for example, how much the classifier has changed or how much the predicted labels have changed or how the feature space looks, basically. So one strategy we, for example, use is we calculate dimension reduction of our feature space, for example, with a PCA or a T-SNE or UMAP, and colorize it by the decisions of the human annotator and by the prediction of the classifier. And then this is like this cluster homogeneity. The human annotator sees how the feature space approximately looks and can say, okay, I have, for example, here 8 clusters. Here I visualize the decisions of the classifier on the unlabeled data set, and I see, okay, I don't know, 5 clusters are class blue, 2 clusters are class red, and there are no inhomogeneities in this cluster. Maybe I, as a human annotator, say, this problem has converged after I've been working on it for 4 hours, and I will go to the next data set. You can also, as I said before, track the changes the classifier makes on the pool of unlabeled data and present it also as a graph which should be decreasing over time. And then the human editor can stop. You can also pull this into some kind of number or metric yourself, which then signals like a traffic light and says, hey, you can stop now. But this is basically your own decision. We usually, because we have experienced human analysts working on this problem, we usually say, okay, as an analyst, it's your responsibility to notice the convergence based on the visual aids we give you. And this usually works well. Yeah, and just to come to my conclusion, active learning can help you if you have a large set of unlabeled data and need to label it with a limited budget. There is no best query algorithm. Use a subset of them, iterate, test. There is no best way to measure convergence. Maybe you can trust your annotator, maybe you can't. Depends on problem. Maybe you stop after the budget is exhausted. And of course, this is not a problem-free method. It has also some disadvantages. So active learning can have problems if you have noisy annotators. So my human analysts at my company are experienced and make almost no mistakes. But if you put your problem up on Amazon Mechanical Turk for 5 cents per click, maybe people are not working right or have high error rates, then you have to consider this in your algorithms. Maybe you need to discover classes and don't know how much classes you have beforehand, and your problems can also be can risky to use active learning then. And if you use something like expected model change or expected error reduction, then you need to consider what kind of machine learning classifiers you are using. If you're using something which has a very, very slow speed of training, like a convolutional neural network, you cannot, I don't know, train 5,000 convolutional neural networks just to select one instance for the human annotator. But if you have something fast, like an SVM or a random forest, this can work out. You have to look at it, depending on your problem. And yeah. And in the end, as I promised, there is some Python here. So we looked up. So at our company, we don't use any of these packages. We have built this stuff on our own with scikit-learn, because you don't need much lines of code to do active learning. It's, I don't know, 10, 20, or 100 lines of Python code to implement these algorithms. But there are people who have done it already. You can look at this at these packages. They are mostly following a scikit-learn RP, can be used with every scikit-learn classifier. Some of them are actively maintained, one is not. This is like the table which is shown here, and the sample of code posted here looks also very similar if you are familiar with scikit-learn. Yeah, and this is basically it, and I hope you enjoyed my talk on active learning, and please feel free to ask me any question which comes to your mind.
Questions?
Hi, thank you very much for this interesting talk. I have one question regarding this boundary which you had, where you said essentially it could be suboptimal when you query around this boundary. And I know that in certain pathological examples, you can actually get wrong results. Essentially, you bias your results by active learning. Does this play a role in reality? Is this merely a theoretical consideration? Could you maybe elaborate? Thank you very much.
Yeah, so you are absolutely correct. These uncertainty sample usually tends to look at outliers very much, and this can result in biased classifiers in the end. And this is one of our motivations to iterate over different sampling strategies over time. Because what we saw in our practical applications was, if you just stick to one of these strategies, you always run into pitfalls. You have to iterate over them, and usually they compensate the disadvantages, and you get an hopefully unbiased result in the end.
Do you think that in the future there is a way to get rid of the human interaction? Like that classification will be done automatically as well?
So there are several ways to get the human out of the loop. So remember the talk of my predecessor who talked about semi-supervised learning. There you can work with data sets which have only very few labels without incorporating a human. And it's also very much dependent on your problem. So in this industrial application I work on, asset care and integrity, we have to incorporate a human by law. It's required to have at least some human interaction with such a problem. But I think that with semi-supervised learning, you can get rid of the human very well, because there's much research like the semi-supervised guns and other algorithms.
Any more questions?
Thanks again for the talk. You mentioned that you combine different strategies. Does this mean that you use one strategy that you first select all the samples using one strategy, then switch to another strategy, or do you iterate over all of them and use them during the entire process?
We iterate over all of them. So one instance is selected by algorithm A, then one is by algorithm B, and then one by algorithm C. This was one of the first stages of our project. And after that, we started working on meta-algorithms for selecting the selection algorithm, which can also work very well, because selecting a selection algorithm is also a multi-arm bandit problem. You can say your selection algorithm is one of the bandits, and then you can say, okay, which of the selection algorithms has shown the best performance over time, and allocate resources to the selection algorithms based on its performance in the past.
Any other questions?
Hi, thanks again for the talk. In the supervised case, is it still worth to do something like that because you have faster convergence of the classifier, or it's more robust or anything like that?
So I wouldn't use active learning in a purely supervised case where I already have a largely labeled data set, just because you have to involve a human, which comes with a budget and costs. You could always do it if the human costs here is not relevant to you, but then you have to compare performances. There might be cases where active learning might perform better than supervised learning on the full data set. But it really, really much depends on your problem. There are no general answers here. So in our cases, if you have the whole data set already labeled, in my application, purely supervised learning was better than active learning. But in your application, it might be the other way around.
Thank you.
One last question. Sorry. Yeah. ask for it.
Hello. You've mentioned class discovery as a just remaining issue. Could you comment on this? When are you adding new classes? Are you asking this mechanical toolkit to add, or you are using some heuristics for this?
So this was just a consideration for me, because in the problem I work on, I know all the classes beforehand, because in our industrial applications, the number of defects is known beforehand. But in a real world problem, this is really, really nasty, because if you don't know the number of classes, then it's basically very hard to use active learning. You could start with a long iteration of deterministic querying and random sampling until you say, okay, I've not seen new classes in the last 10 or 20 iterations, and now I can start using uncertainty sampling, for example. But again, there is also no right answer. But if I would have to design a system for such a problem where I don't know the number of classes beforehand, I would allocate a lot of labeling resources on random queries and deterministic querying with some kind of stopping criterion. So I haven't seen classes in that many iterations, and now I switch over to other sampling strategies. This, from my point of view, might work, but again, there is no best way. It might also not work in your case, for example. It's always test, test, test.
Okay, we are out of time. Let's give it up one last time for the speaker.